Hello everyone, I am Khushbu Sharma, Assistant Professor in G.H. Ryerson Institute of Engineering and Technology. My department is first year and I am the physics faculty. Welcome you all for the engineering physics session. Before going for the engineering physics session, I would like to throw light on the physics. What is physics? So physics is a branch of science, is a basic science that deals with the real things, that deals with the interaction of energy and matter. It tells about what is energy, it tells about what is matter and about their interactions. So physics is a very important for technology and the for recent development aspect, because physics play a key role for the development of the humankind. So we can't ignore physics subject when we are concerned about the development of technology, development of nation. So physics is a very important. So as far as engineering concern, it is very important ki what type of physics knowledge should be gained by the engineering student, future coming engineering students. So as we are going for this, for giving the knowledge to the, to pursue the knowledge to the engineering student, so we should know that the what is the recent technology is going, what is the recent principle fundamental is going on the in the field of science, in the field of physics. So for this, as per Artemen University, the physics is the vast space of the physics, the vast area of the physics, but for engineering students it is very important to go for only application part of the for the becoming engineers. Okay, so in physics, the if you are concerned about the engineering, so it is what engineering applied physics. Physics is divided into pure physics and applied physics. So as far as engineering concern, applied physics is very important. So as we go for further for the applied physics, then furtherly applied physics as per RTMN Nagpur University, this applied physics is divided into two parts. The two part is this, like this: applied physics is divided into two parts in RTMN Nagpur University. First is engineering physics, and the second one is called advanced physics. So in first sem, students deal with the engineering physics, and in second sem they concern about, they deal with the advanced physics. So engineering physics, in first sem they discuss about the engineering physics, they gain the knowledge about the engineering physics, and in second sem they gains about the advanced physics is there. So now today we have session, now we will discuss about the engineering physics topic. So engineering physics, that means the physics for the engineers, it is completely devoted to the engineers and completely devoted to the application part of the physics that we can use for the recent development of the nation and the technology. So as per Artemen University, engineering physics there are four units is there. Unit 1 is called the quantum mechanics, and the unit 2 is called wave packet and wave function. Third unit is there. Third unit is a crystal structure, And the fourth unit is semiconductor physics. Okay, so four unit is there: quantum mechanics, wave packet and wave function, and the third unit is crystal structure, and the fourth unit is quantum mechanics. This is unit 1, this is unit 2, this is unit 3, and this is unit 4. These four units cover the engineering physics, the whole subject. So first of all, I would like to discuss about the quantum mechanics. This is our first unit, quantum mechanics. So quantum mechanics, as the name is entitled, with the quantum mechanics. Quanta means energy packets. It is introduced, this word is first of all used by Max Planck, the famous scientist, in 1900. Quantum mechanics is a very important part of the physics, applied physics, because physics is about the real things, real phenomena that is going on, the nature. Okay, so quantum mechanics is a branch of science, is a topic where we deal with the small scale bodies. Small scale means, you can say in other word, is a microscopic body. There are two type bodies is there: microscopic and macroscopic. Micro, that means small bodies that we can't see with our naked eyes, like atomic particles, like subatomic particles, photon, electron, proton, neutron. This is called the microscopic bodies. And in other side, macroscopic bodies, that is heavy bodies that we can see with our naked eyes, like cricket ball. Okay, we can't see electron, but we can see the cricket ball. Like this is the pointer. I can see this pointer, but I can't see its electron is there. So this pointer is a macroscopic body, but this electron is called microscopic body. So quantum mechanics basically for the microscopic body. So simple thing that is we can understand about the quantum mechanics is that in quantum mechanics, simple, if you are saying that light, so light is when we say about the light, the things come in our mind is that it's having the waving nature. But quantum mechanics tells us, yes, light having the waving nature, it's have the wave, but it's also having particle nature as well. So quantum mechanics tells us about the duality of the natures, duality of the things. In one part it says wave also having particle property, and another side it says that particle also having the waving nature. So in quantum mechanics, we deals with the small things, small scale, small structure of the elements, and about their waving nature, about their physical properties. So in quantum mechanics, there are lot of topic is there, a very very important topic is there. The first topic in the quantum mechanics is the Max Planck hypothesis. Max Planck hypothesis is a first revolutionary hypothesis that changed the scientist scenario, like that we are not concerned, we should not concern about the only heavy body, we should also concern about their elementary particle as well. So in 1900 Max Planck given this theory, suggested this theory. So we in tentatively we call that before 1900 this physics is called the classical mechanics, and after 1900, after the Max Planck's theory, that physics introduced, the new chapter is introduced about the physics, this is called that quantum mechanics. So it's a recent physics, recent innovations, recent principle is there. So that is called the quantum mechanics. So Max, if you're concerned about the quantum mechanics, so we should know about the Max Planck hypothesis, because very very important. It's a opening door for the quantum mechanics. So first is the Max Planck hypothesis is there. Number two, next topic, it will be the properties of photons. If you are saying that light is a stream of photon, light is having the, yes, is still having the waving nature, but some property we can't explain by keeping in the mind that light is having the waving nature. Like if you are saying the black body radiation is there, so we can't explain black body radiation on the basis of only wave. We should also concern in our mind that light having what? Photons. So we should know about the properties of photon. The next topic in the quantum mechanics is that Compton effect is there. Compton effect is a very very important phenomena, because because quantum effect is give, this is the effect, this is the first effect that we can't explain with the help of the classical mechanics, that that suggested that, that indicated that no, classical mechanics is not the whole so where things is there, quantum mechanics also exists over here in the physics concepts, okay. So Compton effect is a very very important topic, and when as we discussed, we will discuss about the Compton effect. Afterwards de Broglie hypothesis is there, de Broglie hypothesis is in 1909, they all these things are related to 19th centuries is there, in 1900 Max Planck, in 1906 Compton effect is there, in 1909 is de Broglie hypothesis is there. In de Broglie, what is de Broglie hypothesis? I hope students are much aware about the de Broglie hypothesis in their 11th 12th class, but I should recall to the de Broglie hypothesis again, is that de Broglie suggested that not light having the dual nature, also particle exhibits such kind of dualism, that means the small particles also having waving nature. So this is the de Broglie hypothesis is there. After de Broglie hypothesis, one topic is also existing, because at the time of de Broglie they just given the hypothesis, they don't have that time such experimental proof, they are not they was not with the their experimental proof of the de Broglie hypothesis. So peoples of that time, they are just confused about the is that the de Broglie is correct, is it the de Broglie is true or not, okay. So when the in after 1-2 years, Davison Jomo, a two scientists set up a experimental setup for the de Broglie hypothesis, and they took a diffraction pattern of the electromagnetic electron rays, and they concluded in a very good result, and they suggested that no, de Broglie is a very very correct hypothesis. And after the experimental setup of the after the experimental proof of the Davison Jomo, de Broglie awarded with the Nobel Prize. So if you are concerned about the quantum mechanics, these 4 to 5 topics are very very important. Number one, Planck-Compton hypothesis. Number two, as the properties of photons, what is photon, what is their mass, what is their momentum, what is their velocity, and afterwards Compton effect, de Broglie hypothesis is there, de Broglie hypothesis is the their experimental proof, that is called Davison-Jomo experiment. So in this way we will complete the quantum mechanics, the first unit of their engineering physics. And as we done the quantum mechanics, the next unit is the wave packet and the wave function is there. Wave packet and wave function, we gone through about what is photons, what is electron, it's having the wave in a unit one. But what happened when all the atoms are joining to form element, each atom having the wave? If we are considering about the element, so what will happen? There are different types. There are million billions of waves that is representing the individual atoms is there. That means each atom having the wave. Then if each atom are joining to combine to form the element, then what will happen? Elements have number of waves is there. What will we do with this? There's a lot of number of waves is there. So wave packet and the wave function is that if the atoms having the different waves is there, so they get superimposed and thus. And this they get superimposed and we get the final wave is there, and this is called what? Wave packet. So wave packet means a superposition, a combination of different waves of almost same amplitude and almost same frequency. So this is called the wave packet. So wave packet is a, you can say that the wave packet and wave function are second unit, is the second step for the quantum mechanics. This is the first step and this is the second step, wave packet and wave function. So wave packet in wave function, first of all we will deal with the what is wave packet, okay, what is the definition of wave, what do you understand by the wave packet, then we go for their velocity. Their velocity is called the phase velocity and group velocity. Phase velocity concern about the velocity of single wave, and the group velocity is concern about the velocity of whole group, okay. And afterwards the phase velocity and the group velocity, the next thing is that Eisenberg uncertainty principle. Eisenberg is very very important, because if you are saying that the wave particle having the wave nature, then what about their wavelength and what about their momentum, what about their energy, whatever their position. So Eisenberg is a very, very important conclusion, very, very important topic if you are concerned about the position, momentum and their calculation. So Eisenberg uncertainty principle, Eisenberg uncertainty principle in short is called HUP, Eisenberg uncertainty principle, and it is given by del X into del P. Del P is greater or equal than H upon 2 pi. So Eisenberg uncertainty principle means it tells that if you know the momentum, we can determine the position of the waves, and if we know the position, we can determine the momentum of the waves. So Eisenberg uncertainty principle, its proof is also is there in this unit. And after this Eisenberg uncertainty principle HUP, there is a one topic is also important, that is called the wave function. That is, the name is also included in this, wave function is there, wave function. And the wave function means psi. You know, students are aware about, you know, the tenth class, this psi function, this is called, this wave function is there. And the wave function means we will discuss about the physical properties, what is wave function, what is the physical properties, what is the importance of it. And as we done it, we will go for the very important equation of this this related to this unit, that is called a Schrodinger equation. Schrodinger equation, it's in simple term, in general term, is called the wave equation. We are saying that particle having the wave, then what about, how will we determine its physical property by using the waving nature? So Eisenberg uncertainty principle is a Schrodinger equation is a very important, pardon, Schrodinger equation very important. And Schrodinger equation, there are two types of Schrodinger equation is there, time dependent and time independent. And as we will discuss the Schrodinger equation, next topic will be for this unit, and the last topic is a potential well, one dimension potential well, in which we will tell that then how electron will treat it when its depth in a high depth of well, how it is going on if you are saying that electron is here and it's moving from here to here, then what happen here, how is the wave equation is given by, how is the energy of such kind of electron if it's confined in a one dimensional potential well. So all these topics included in our second unit, wave packet and the wave function. As we done the wave packet and wave function, the third unit would be crystal structure. Crystal structure, as name is saying, crystal what? All the things, we can say that in general time we said all the transparent thing is not crystal, but this unit differently losing our before concept that is that all transparent thing is not the crystal. Crystal having different meaning, different significances there. So a solid which having the, which atoms are arranged in a regular and periodic manner, such as solids are called the crystal. And as we will go for the fundamental of the crystal, then we will discuss about the what is the crystal structure, how the crystal structure is formed, what is the basic requirement for getting a crystal structure, and type of the crystal structure. There are 7 type of crystal structures there, but as far as the engineering physics concerned, we will discuss about the one type of crystal, that is a cubic unit cell. So there are cubic unit cell, there are 3 types there, simple cubic unit cell, that is in short is called SC, and thus in second is called the body centered cubic unit cell, and third is called the face centered cubic unit cell. Body centered cubic unit cell, face centered cubic unit cell, this was the topic almost all of the student have discussed in our 11th and 12th class as well. Okay, so we will go for the advance of this one. So simple cubic unit cell, body centered unit cell and FCC. So as we will done the fundamental of simple cubic, BCC and the FCC, the next thing is that what are their parameters, what is their atomic radius, what will be their number of atom per unit cell, what will be their atomic packing fraction is there, how will be their void space is there. Packing fraction means how much space is occupied, means if this is the structure of the atom and this is the structure of atom is there and these are the atoms is there, then the how much space is occupied by the atoms, okay, so we do the calculation, how much escape, is there 30%, is there 40% or something else, okay. So this is called the atomic fraction, so one of the parameter of the simple cubic BCC and FCC. And afterwards we will discuss void space. Void space is just a complement of the atomic packing fraction. If APF is gives that how much space is occupied, so void space gives the how much space is not occupied, the blank space, that unutilized space in a unit cell is called void space. So very important and very interesting parameter is there, like atomic radius, effective number, atomic radius, effective number, coordination number, tightening of the structures, atomic packing fraction, void space. And as we will learn this such a very important parameters, the one and very important phenomena for the crystal structure, without that crystal structure is incomplete, and that is called what? Bragg's law. Bragg's law, it gives the structure, is gives the information about the crystal structure. If I'm saying that the crystal is crystal having the simple cubic nature, if I'm saying that this crystal having the body centered cubic in itself, then how, on what basis I am saying like this? So this crystal structure gives the support of such kind of a statement, because it use the X-ray diffraction, and with the help of the X-ray diffraction we can determine the crystal of the structure. So as far as the crystal structure concerned, Bragg's law is a most important topic for it. And as crystal structure, Bragg's law is there, so we will draw some planes on the, or we also in a crystal structure is there, we will draw, if we know the Miller and Dasses, we will draw the some planes by using the intercept points. Okay, so these things, topics are used in a crystal structure. And the last but not least, the last topic of this engineering physics, the last unit of this engineering physics is the semiconductor physics. Semiconductor physics, I know all the students are already aware about the semiconductor physics, because they have topic in their 11th class, 10th class, even they have the definition in 9th, 10th class as well, okay, what is semiconductor. But in this engineering physics, we will discuss about some advanced topics, some advanced recent innovations is there in the semiconductor physics. So we will, first of all, we will start with the basic concept. What is band theory? What do you mean by energy band gap? What is valence band? What is conduction band? What is forbidden energy band gap? And as we learn this such kind of very important and parameters, then we divide the solid into three categories. Number one is called conductor, and number two is called semiconductor. And number three is called insulator. Okay, so solid are divided into, as per their conductivity, divided into three categories: conductor, semiconductor and insulator. Conductor, those they can allow the to flow the current, is called, they can allow the current, they can allow the flow of free electron, is called conductor. We have very good example of conductor is there, like silver is there, gold is there, copper is there. Now next, insulator means they don't allow to flow the current, to flow the free electrons. Like this is also the bad conductor of the electricity. Glass, wood, mica are the bad conductor of the electricity. We are aware about this already. Okay, so next thing is that semiconductor physics, the last one and the point of our concern, the semiconductor name is also tells its definition, that sometime it's behave like a conductor and sometime it's behave like a insulator. It's a just a mid of the conductor and the insulator material. So say there are very good example of semiconductor are silicon is there, germanium is there. Silicon is abundant in the earth, so it's a very cheap material is in this earth, is that silicon. And the semiconductor, we will discuss first of all type of the semiconductor. What is the type of semiconductor? Pure and impure. It's in a technical language called the intrinsic semiconductor and extrinsic semiconductor. As we will discuss such intrinsic and extrinsic semiconductor, the next thing is that what is what is the type of the extrinsic semiconductor? So there are two type, p type semiconductor and n type semiconductor. How p is formed, how n is formed, and as we will learn this one, we will go for the PN junction diode. PN junction diode is a device, is a semiconductor device in which two type of semiconductor is there. One type is called P and one type is called the N. And if a semiconductor plate is one part is formed P and one part is formed N, the junction line between the PN junction is called the boundary line between the P type and N type is called the PN junction. And it's having the two electrodes there, one is anode and one is cathode. So this is called PN junction diode. And PN junction diode, so as we will discuss about the PN junction diode, lot of diode also here that is already introduced in a technology that is using very widely in industrial, in the domestic as well. So like LEDs, light emitting diode is there, photodiodes is there, tunnel diode is there, zener diode is there. So the different diode is there. So we will discuss upon the different diodes and their VI characteristics as well. VI characteristics mean to say, that means we will discuss the how the voltage, how the current is flowing if we increasing the voltage, that is called the VI characteristics. As we will discuss this such kind of diode, as we will have we gone through with this it, then the next topic in a semiconductor physics is the transistor. Transistor is a very, very revolutionary invention in the part of the semiconductor physics. There are two type of transistor is there, PNP transistor and NPN transistor. PNP transistor sometimes is called the P-type transistor. And NPN sometimes is called the N-type transistor is there. It's a very, very good amplifier. It's used in amplification purpose. And there are three configuration is possible in the semiconductor physics: common base, common emitter, and common collector is there. And as we will discuss all three configuration and all the important parts of the transistor, like emitter, base, and collector, we will discuss about there how the transistor can be used as an amplifier. What is the important configuration for doing this? And we will discuss about the VI characteristics of transistor. There are some parameters will be there, and as we will done the semiconductors whatsoever. So in this way we will go through the one by one in the all these units, like quantum, wave packet, crystal structure, and semiconductor physics is there. And as we will start with a very, very important topic with the quantum mechanics in the next lecture, I hope you will you get the proper knowledge of the basic of this engineering physics that we will discuss in our next lecture. First unit will be the quantum, second unit will be the wave packet and the wave function, and the third unit will be the crystal structure, and the fourth unit is the semiconductor physics. We will go with the one by one, and in next lecture we will discuss quantum mechanics, and we will go for the introductory part, how the quantum mechanics introduced, and then we will go for the Max Planck hypothesis. Okay, I hope you understood about this session completely. Thank you so much.